Hello and welcome to Some Assembly Required. The previous video ended with our Apple II clone finally booting, but we only knew that by following graphs in a simulator. Ideally, we'd like to see with our own eyes the Apple II boot sequence. Sadly, our Spartan's main display mechanism is an HDMI port. It will take too long to get a picture out of that one. Instead, I'm going to use this port. Now, this may seem like a USB port, but it's not a generic USB port. It connects to this chip, which is the CP2102, which is a serial to USB adapter. In other words, UART. UART, or Universal Asynchronous Receiver Transmitter, is just about the first core anyone learning to program FPGAs implements, and with good reason. It's simple and very useful. It signals idle with a value set to 1. It signals start of communication with the voltage going to 0 for one symbol time, that is the time it takes the protocol to transmit one bit. This time is determined by the baud rate and has to be agreed upon by both sender and receiver, and concludes with the voltage going to logical 1 for at least one symbol length. If more bytes are to be sent, then immediately after one symbol length, the voltage will go to logical 0, starting the next transfer. If no more bytes are to be sent, the voltage remains at 1 to indicate idle. The 0 bit at the beginning is called the start bit, the 1 bit at the end is called the stop bit. The communication can be parameterized, changing the number of data bits, number of stop bits, and also adding a parity bit for verifying data integrity. The Some Assembly Required GitHub page has a project called UART that has my implementation of the protocol. UART send is implemented basically with a shift register. The inputs are the base clock. Note, this clock doesn't count at the symbol rate, but rather much higher, and we're using a divider to determine the actual symbol rate. It signals when it's ready to get a new data to send, i.e. when it's idle or about to be, and of course the actual output. The shift register is loaded with a stop bit, data in, and start bit. So the start bit is in the least significant bits of the shift register. At this point, outbit is connected to the least significant bit of the shift register, and we're using the clock to shift down the register. And really, that's all there is to it. UART receive is only slightly more complicated. We're using the higher clock rate to try and sample each symbol at the middle of it. This way, if there's a clock drift between our clock and the sender's clock, we maximize the chances of reading the correct data. So now we need to create a display controller. The Apple II text area is located at addresses 400 through 800, or actually 7FF. We use single port RAM for most of the RAM we used on the Apple II, but the segment that handles the 400 addresses was connected to a dual port RAM. Unlike a single port RAM that has a single address input and then has a single data output, a dual port RAM has two address inputs and two data outputs. So it can read and write from two locations at the same time. This allows the display to read the text area even as the CPU is working. On the Apple II, they used a different trick. They used RAM chips that were faster than what the CPU needed. Since the 6502 only ever needs the data at the falling edge of the clock, they used the low phase of the clock to read the display data. The display data is then routed to a display controller. The display controller uses a state machine in order to determine which state it is in. 30 times a second, it starts a new sequence where it first sends a clear screen sequence and then starts dumping the old address to the UART controller. Which means we can finally see the display through the UART. Hooray! Moment of truth. Wow, this is both a great success and also a real failure. On the one hand, we did get the Apple II logo, and here we also have the prompt. For reference, this is how it's supposed to look. So it's close, but we're not really there. We got the logo and the prompt, but the prompt isn't where it's supposed to be. It was supposed to be on the third line. We also got these strange at symbols and no cursor. So let's tackle them one at a time. The Apple II text page isn't continuous. It starts at 400, and the first 40 bytes are indeed continuous, but it then jumps a third of the screen down. 40 bytes on, and it jumps another third of the screen down. Each line is continuous in memory, but at the end of the first line of the bottom third, there are 8 bytes that are not displayed at all. The next byte over is the second line on the first third. It's not entirely clear to me why Steve Wozniak implemented it the way he did. Wikipedia claims that this eliminated the need for a dedicated memory refresh circuitry, but I'm not sure I see how that happens. I guess it's not 100% accurate. I can kinda see how that might work, but it definitely tells me that Steve Wozniak was, no pun intended, and probably still is, a genius. Either way, that's the way it is. That's the way we need to implement it. So when we're reading the memory sequentially, we're actually reading the first line of the top, middle, and bottom thirds, followed by 8 at signs that are just the zeros in the 8 bytes that are not displayed, followed by the second line on the top, middle, and bottom thirds, more 8 undisplayed bytes, and finally our prompt at the third line of the screen. If we want the display to show up correctly, we need a different scan order. Moment of truth. And we have a display. Hooray! We still don't have a cursor though, so let's see how that works. The mapping between the value we actually write to the text page and what gets displayed is somewhat non-straightforward. ASCII is 7-bit. If we write a value with bit 7 set, we see that 1 translates to 4-1. So there seems to be an inversion of bit 6. However, that's not the whole story. If we try to set a value that already has bit 6 set in ASCII, we're not getting lowercase a, we get an exclamation mark. We handle that by using a translate data function that reverses this transform. We're not done, however. If bit 7 is clear, we're getting the same text except in inverse. And this time, if bit 6 is set, we're getting the same value except flashing. This may seem like a strange translation, but please remember that the Apple II Plus did not have lowercase. Yeah, okay, it is a strange translation. So here's what we're going to do. We define the escape sequence for normal and inverse mode. This sequence, if sent to an ANSI-compatible terminal, will switch the mode in which characters are displayed. So what we need to do is, before displaying each character, find out which mode it belongs to. This is done in the getDesiredState function. If the state returned is different than the currently active state, instead of sending the next character, we send the escape sequence for switching to the desired state. Let's see how that works. We got the cursor. Of course, it's not flashing, and we still can't input, but it's progress. Let's make it flash. Essentially, at 30 frames a second, flashing means sending normal text for 8 frames, followed by sending inverse text for 8 frames. So let's see how that works. We set up a frame counter. This frame counter is 4 bits, so it can only count from 0 to 15. That's useful as we're going to use the overflow. The getDesiredState function works as before, except for flashing text, it checks the frame counter. If it's less than 8, it sends inverse mode. Otherwise, it sends normal mode. And we have a flashing cursor. Well, we're definitely in a better place than we were at the end of the previous video. We can actually see with our eyes the computer is indeed booting. Next video, we'll add keyboard input so that we'll be able to run some basic programs. Until then, thank you for watching.